Jared has been with us at every workshop and will probably be with us at every workshop. When I was putting together the Berkeley workshop, I made a decision to go outside of the university to choose somebody to come and talk to us about creating resumes for several reasons, one of which I want to talk about here. I think it's important for us to get outside of the university. I mean, that's part one of the reasons why we don't hold these events on campus. We hold them in various spaces. I think it changes the conversations we have, changes how we think about things. And I thought it was important, especially around the resume, which is a very sensitive topic, actually, it turns out. I wanted to get somebody who could provide what I've talked about as like a moments of encounter. So somebody who doesn't necessarily already know us, right? And it's interesting, I just learned today, actually just a few minutes ago, that Jared was a recruiter, and I knew he was a recruiter. What I did not know was that as a recruiter, he was told that he did not even look at PhD resumes, right? So you have somebody in this position who's making choices about who to employ, and he wouldn't even look at PhDs, right? So Jared is somebody, though, who is very interested in thinking alongside of us in terms of what the PhD is good for, how does it work, what kind of work do we do, and helping us make that transition from, not necessarily a transition from a CV to a resume, but thinking about the work that we do as graduate students and in the academy to the world of work more generally. So Jared is here today. He will be doing two presentations. The first is Resume Redux, using the writing process as a tool for career discovery, as well as a breakout session. Over the past couple of years, as we've had extra funds, we were able to provide one-on-one sessions with Jared. So graduate students were able to meet with Jared for 2 half-hour sessions to have personalized assistance on resumes. And it's been incredibly helpful for the graduate students who went through that process. And it's been incredibly helpful for Jared and for us at UCHRI to think about what your needs are and perhaps how they are and are not being met. And so as we were putting together this workshop, Jared suggested, based upon his work with a graduate student, that he co-facilitate this session. So Dana Linda from UCLA, Dana's waving her hand, Dana will be joining Jared off stage in a minute. They collaborated on this presentation, and we're really, in the spirit of experimentation, we're really excited to see how this resume presentation has changed. Jared, I'll turn it over to you.
Wonderful, thank you, Kelly, and nice to see everybody. I'm really, really happy to be here again and to talk about my favorite subject, the resume. And the work I do out of my practice in San Francisco, the Resume Studio, is sort of to help people reverse engineer where they may want to go in their careers. I have people frequently coming to me who are 15 to 25 years out, and they say, you know, I've done X and a little bit of Y for so many years, and I'm a little bored, and I want to know how what I've done might translate into something else. Frequently, they have one or two roles that they've really wondered about, and sometimes a third. And so I've developed tools and processes around over time that help them through that. So I'm excited to sort of be able to translate this work into what graduate students are doing. And one of the most sort of interesting things for me has been to work one-on-one with folks who went through that hour and a half presentation at Berkeley, where I played Oprah for a couple of minutes. And also then the San Diego experience, and that's what I'm going to call it, the San Diego experience. My background is as a musician many, many years, and along the way, when I moved to New York, I fell into a consulting firm, and part of that firm was something called Retained Executive Search, basically a recruiter. So I fell into recruiting really quite by accident, and I spent a number of years in search, both on the nonprofit side and also on the corporate side. And I always say, had I not had that experience, I would not be able to do what I do today. So I have to sort of acknowledge that so many times the career that we thought we might have, sort of you pivot along the way and you have opportunities that open up your eyes to sort of new and interesting things. So it's not uncommon, certainly, because I work with people and see inside their careers quite a lot. I want to do something that by the way, if you want to work at your laptops, please feel very free to do that, because if you may have some ideas and I want you to capture them here and now. I don't care if you're looking at me or at your laptop or surfing Google, I suppose, but please feel free to do that. And to the folks who are over here, my apologies for sort of blocking your view. We had an issue of whether I could see the slides or not, and so here we are. So I want to go back to something that I was about to start, and that is that I don't like reading verbatim, but there are some things I wanted to share with you that I put down a couple nights ago and sort of have... Basically, I'm going to read aloud for a moment because there are some things I want to make sure I cover. So I think that writing clearly is really hard work. I think it's especially tough when you're having to sort of write objectively about yourself while simultaneously translating experience that's important and even essential, but not easily understood outside of or maybe even alongside a traditional academic track. Having to define what you do and have done, and point that toward what you might want to do, and even when you may not know what you want to do, is what the careers world that I'm in calls career discovery. So the folks I work with, as I mentioned, are usually 15 to 25 years out into their career, and frequently they say, if I had only known this when I got out of graduate school. So that's basically where we are. We have this opportunity now for this to sort of happen. One big challenge for me is I'm here to help address translating your story if you're looking at or thinking about jobs that sort of aren't obvious. And of course, that's what I've been discussing since Berkeley. My challenge as an expert, though, is in sharing something as narrow as resume writing, is that a document that can mean so much to your career and yet is so often, by the way, untended until the very last minute, and frequently at a time that is frightening and disruptive in your life. My challenge is to translate what I do one-on-one with people. We tried to do 1-on-80 in San Diego, for instance, but what I do one-on-one into something that is useful without me. And so are there pieces that we can leave behind that people can go through on their own, a programmatic sort of process that you can follow? And that's partly what I have in mind as I'm going through this. How do we codify and make this happen? I think that your challenge is similar in some ways. You have to translate what you've done, your experience, and simplify it and make it clear to an audience that might not get it if it's not presented in a way that they don't understand or value. I think we're getting closer to that translation, and today I'm here to talk about not only the tools that I think will help, in fact I know will help, but also to show several examples from peers of yours, as Kelly suggested a moment ago, with whom I've worked one-on-one since the beginning of my collaboration here with UCHRI. And several of those folks are in the room, I'm happy to say. So also, I'm going to now flip over to the clock app, so I can keep track of where we are on time. So the first thing I want to talk about is the concept of using the writing process as a tool for career discovery. And I wrote that in the marketing materials because that is how I see it. You can't write something that is clear or instructive to your recipient unless you've wrestled with it and unless you have made it clear. And for when you don't know what that looks like, all of these things that we're about to do are an overarching or even an underlying concept. So the idea of using writing as a tool for career discovery is a part of this whole experience that we're having. The first suggestion I have is instead of looking at your resume as a once and done type of a chore, and a lot of people do look at it as a chore. I saw how many people last night downloaded the job description analysis at the last minute. I left the dinner a little bit early and went and checked email, and it was like, brrr, all these people had downloaded. I was like, too late. But it's a chore, right? It's not that interesting. So it instead is a dynamic and continual growth experience. And I think the sooner you sort of have that perception of the resume, I think the better off you'll be, certainly in years to come. I spoke with one of the folks with whom I worked, and she helped sort of answer a few questions, and she said, and by the way, I was just doing another job description analysis based on another job that I thought might be interesting. So it's nice that it's living and breathing outside of the work I do. So again, developing a resume requires work, developing a resume that works requires that you begin translating who you are with where you want to go. You're looking at that intersection of those things, and that isn't always self-evident. Now, what we want to do is the things you do, right? Those are simply what we call skills, will be the things that you use to translate your experience to a new audience, which, by the way, are going to lead to sort of a little set of keywords that you'll not only use in your resume and on LinkedIn, but I would suggest that you use those keywords as sort of clues in your own search for potential jobs and opportunities that you might not know about. And the third is really to sort of take the research and to construct sort of new discoveries like you have always done, but this time you're going to turn it around and do it on your own behalf. So when I talked about doing some research, LinkedIn is a great tool for doing research of this kind. If you see, let's say, program administration is something we're going to talk about a little later today. Program administration is a keyword or a key phrase that you can enter into advanced search on LinkedIn. And there's a little button that says advanced search. Make sure you click that. And you can filter up or down. You can filter the responses you'll get. And you'll find that, oh, program administration is maybe something that people inside of a tech company will do. Oh, I never really thought about it in that way. Or program management. Oh, program management is actually the whole sort of life cycle of a product that's being developed. And the person who's managing that program is actually managing all the engineers and the marketers and the developers and all those people in this really, and you're like, oh, I had no idea that what I do on a day-to-day basis, that may be something I can aim for because it's using the same skill set. So that's an example, again, of taking a keyword that you've identified, grabbing onto it, and we'll talk about how we're identifying those later, and using it as something that you're going to use as a tool to find out who else is doing what. The other is you can use Google to do the same, like just type it in and start using Google in the way you normally do and say, what kinds of roles are associated with this skill, the thing that you do. And then Indeed.com is another great site. Indeed.com is an aggregator of job postings from around the internet, and you're probably, some of you might be familiar with it. Make sure that you track what you discover and keep following those breadcrumbs, and I think that that's going to be a continual process. I know that people I work with now who have worked with me for many years still go back to the job description analysis and say, okay, what are the breadcrumbs telling me at this point? So just a real quick overview about what we our work so far and where we're going. So as you know, of course, we started this in May of 2014 at Berkeley. We did San Diego, where I first really drilled down into the job description analysis. And then we had some resume templates. Those are available on that link. If you've seen it, you've seen it. If you haven't, make sure you get to that link and download that. I would like to start adding more material to that same link or something that is also accessible. For instance, some of the samples that we're going to see today. What's new since San Diego, again, I've worked one-on-one with 9 individuals. And what they did is they went through part of the process, they used the template, they said, okay, here's what I've done on my own so far based on everything we've learned. And I spent a half hour and I said, all right, here are some ideas based on, you know, whoever, whatever they were, whoever they were and wherever they wanted to go. Said, let's, you know, here are some ideas. Now, a half hour later, take some time and go spend with that document. And then they came back after that work, and for the next 30 minutes, I basically sort of pressure tested things and edited it for them. They are now getting interviews, and a couple of them have jobs. I hope at some point you'll get to hear about that. Today's activities are, we're going to view some examples, we're going to learn more and discuss the job description analysis, the principles. Some of the folks here have shortened it to JDA, and so JDA has made it into my own sort of the way I talk about the job description analysis. We're going to hear some experiences, and we're going to deliver at the end some what I call bucket examples, and we'll talk about buckets in a minute. In microscopic font, it wasn't microscopic on the screen I was working with before, but all of this is, again, going to be available for download later. All right, the first thing we have to do is we have to become skeptics, because as a recruiter, your job is to be skeptical. You are not looking for, first of all, you're not looking to fail. In some instances, you're working directly with a client, and your client is, let's say, Xerox. Ah, that's old-fashioned. Your client is Facebook. And let's say that it was my job to replace Sheryl Sandberg as the COO. I'm going to be super skeptical about all the stuff that comes to me. And also, I'm going to be pretty fast about it, but it's going to take a long time. So we're going to have this experience as a recruiter in just a moment, and I want you to put on your skeptic's hat. So the you be the recruiter thing we're going to do is we're going to go a little bit behind the scenes, and I want you to think about yourself as not who you are now, but you've been hired by a search firm, and it was quite by accident, and you are now an associate recruiter reporting to a partner. And that partner is also has a reputation of being Cruella de Vil. So she doesn't want to deal with bad choices. The first thing I should ask is, can you all see this screen? Okay, because what we're about to do depends on that. Your mission, present a candidate for your boss to interview. Remember, that boss is Cruella de Vil. Actually, that really doesn't matter, but she's really, really sort of opinionated, and if you get it wrong, she's going to let you know. She wants only the best, absolute closest fit between the job requirements and the 557 resumes that you're about to review. And what's at stake? Well, your job, right? Your job depends on how closely you match the needs of the job in question to the information that you find on a resume that you'll soon review. We need to, Dana, I haven't introduced Dana yet. There's a lovely moment where I do, but we actually don't have an easel. So Dana, would you mind? Oh, we do have an easel. Well, I don't know why. Will that fit up there? Yes. Please welcome Vanna White. Right. Give her a hand. Thank you. All right. So what we've done is we've taken, instead of giving you a job description that you have to read through and isolate skills, we've isolated the skills for you. Two Vannas. Thank you very much. So the first one, remember, you're the recruiter, and your job is to look for an HR leader. That's the piece on the left here. I say an HR leader because that's something that is pretty understandable when you see the skills that are being looked at. It's not like they're the chief architect of a product. So I want you to look at these six skills and just have a look at what those are there on the left. Am I in the way for some of you? Yes, and maybe you'll write these down because you're gonna want, in a minute, you're gonna want them. So comp and benefits is number one, compensation and benefits. Number two is compliance, that's legal compliance. The next one is HR systems. So that is all the technology that makes HR work. Next is performance management. Number five is organizational development. That will ring with some folks in this room, but it's also used in HR. And then the final one is employee training. All right, so in a moment, we're going to take 10 seconds to decide which of the people we see we're going to want to interview. So just look at that list, make sure you know the list, and then I want you to look at the examples you're about to see. There are not 557, there are two. Oh, let me repeat the skills. Okay. Number one is comp and benefits, compensation and benefits. Number two, compliance. Number three, HR systems. Number four, performance management. Number five, organizational development. And finally, employee training. So are you ready to be a recruiter for 10 seconds? All right, now your job is to tell at the end, you know, sort of, well, here we go. Can't see it in the back. These are all online, correct? All right, for those of you who could see it, oh my God, I hope we don't get crickets. But which one would you recommend to your boss? Yes. She said probably the one that uses the keywords in the heading. Yeah, excellent. Sorry? She said, could it be both? That's a great question. Yeah, that's right. One had it grouped under one main heading or two main headings. The other had it built out. I'm going to go back. Oh, nope, go back. Can I go back? Yeah. So the one on the left has two main categories. The one on the right is being more explicit and saying, here we have all these sort of examples and then some details behind it. That was the person took time to build out what those skills were and make it really simple for the person who's sifting through 557 resumes and may only, you know, see those things that are really sort of easily in their face. Yes, a hand. Interesting. The one on the left has more nouns describing the role. The one on the right, wait, am I getting mixed up? Yeah, the one on the right has more verbs. Yeah. Yeah, excellent. It's the one on the right would be the sort of the ideal. Both of them are fine. But if we're looking at the complexity of this HR job, the one on the right is more obvious. And in the stack, it's going to show up a lot more quickly. I have that little guy because that's exactly how a recruiter feels a lot of times. Like, oh my gosh, I have so much to get through. I can't even, you know, believe it. So then, which one would you recommend to your boss? Why or why not? Next up, hello. So this is sort of maybe more familiar, program administrator. We have six skills on the right here. This is manager of regional impact. And that's basically a program administration role, which is why I have that up there. The six skills here are program development, event planning, publicity, program outreach, program evaluation, and then budget management. So let's take 10 seconds to decide who we want to interview or who we want to recommend to interview. All right, again, which one would you recommend to your boss to interview? Yes. It doesn't exist. I was asked by that person to fictionalize it. I was like, everybody here is from one of the 10 UCs, so I'm going to call it the University of Santa Ana Wins. That's exactly right. And she also wanted to be called Liz Lemon, but I didn't have a spot for the in the top. So she said the one on the right, because in terms of organization, there was somewhat of a map. Anyone else? Why would you recommend the one on the right to your boss? She said the one on the right was easier to distill quickly because the information that you wanted needed to see was there, but it was also well-spaced. One more person, why would you recommend it? Yeah. The one on the left, okay. Had to dig down into it. Interesting, she said the one on the left had its own headers and the one on the right was, you had to dig down a little bit more. I think part of that may be because of the size of the screen at the moment, but what's interesting also is that various people are going to have various opinions about your resume and about what should happen. The work I do, by the way, is how do you find center? You're going to have people who say, you always must do this, and then people who say, you always must do that. Well, how do you find center? And how do you, yeah, that's a really great point, so I'm glad you said it. It's really, really good. So I want to talk about bullet points as buckets. And the bullet points as buckets, if you noticed, each of the bullet points had a theme, right? So let's say that program administration was one of those themes. And then the next one might have been program evaluation, although I think those were combined on the example that we gave. What you're able to do is say, okay, those are the buckets around which we want to frame. Those are the main sort of core skills that we want to make sure we make have the reader understand and know. The nice thing about them being on is because they can become interchangeable. and they can become easy to sort of manipulate and edit. So let's say that you had program administration on one of your buckets or bullet points, and the job description asked for what? Program management. All you have to do, because the story is the same, all you have to do is change that out, and it makes the applicant tracking system happy. It also makes the human reader happy because you're sort of saying it in the language that they expect to see. Some of the times when you have sort of things that are synonymous or interchangeable, you need to make those changes in your resume so to where they fit. One thing I just mentioned I realized that I should discuss real quickly is applicant tracking system, also called ATS. Everyone hates them, but many of the biggest companies use them. They are basically the way a computer is programmed to parse all of those 557 resumes or 10,000 resumes. How does one person do that? The computer is tuned to spit out, you know, a subset of those. Well, a lot of really qualified people get looked over, unfortunately. You're like, why didn't I get in there? Because I'm such a slam dunk. Well, because you didn't put in the right material to be found, and so the computer never even let it see a human being. So let's look again at the concept that we're talking about, buckets. And this is microscopic on these screens, guys, I'm sorry. So on the left, we have what we would, if you can see it, a traditional CV. And the CV format, as you can see, works in an academic setting and really is designed for that and is expected. The one on the right is a resume. And what you have on the top is an executive summary. But then down, and then you also have what it's a table of core competencies, also called areas of expertise. When you're just in the beginning stages, or maybe probably first 8 to 10 years of a career, which is certainly not the beginning stages, you can sort of orchestrate your core skills up there in the top. And that becomes really, really easy to manipulate and to sort of edit those to match because let's say that something is that's like department systems. Well, for heaven's sakes, what, you know, department systems, yeah, I get that. But I don't want to write a whole bullet point around it. So that table of skills or core competencies is a great place to do that. And you will see those on a lot of example resumes. But what we're talking about here is these buckets. So I'll read them aloud. There are four here. One is humanities programming, and then there's some story about sort of quantifying that detail. Then there's publication preparation. This person, the job descriptions that she was looking up had publication prep as one of the big, big things. And as you might imagine, the publication was the dissertation, so this is how it was translated. Next up is research administration. That's pretty transferable, obviously. And then finally, budgets and expense management. And that's probably the thing I hear most, like, oh, I hadn't even considered that. And, oh, yeah, by the way, I don't have any budget or expense management experience. But, yeah, you actually might, if you think about it. For the sake of time, because we got started a little late, I'm going to go ahead and move right on. Oh, by the way, what did you think about the sort of 10 seconds to review the examples? Pretty aggravating. It was intended to sort of be a mock experience. I could have given you a stack of resumes and had you go 1, 2, 3, 4, or open them up on your screen and say yes, no, yes, no. And so that's what that experience was really about, to sort of mimic what is happening on the other side of the equation. Is it for all industries or just tech? For a smaller nonprofit, it might not happen because it happens really broadly across industries, yes. Anytime you have a recruiter or a hiring entity that's going to get more than 100 or 200 resumes, that's a lot of them to search through. Yeah, that's a really, really great question. Is there anyone else who has a perspective? Because yes, David. Very good. All right. He said he would say exactly the same thing. Yes. She said, where it might make a difference is someone walks into the manager's office and says, read this one. Yes. That's right. The standard time is 7 seconds. That's right. Same. She can speak to hiring at universities and it's the same. Aggravating, but it's our job to make sure that sort of detail is there. Now, let's shift gears a little bit. So the question is, how did those better, quote-unquote, resumes get that way? And I'm not saying they're better. I'm saying that they're, for our purposes and reading them in 10 seconds, they're easier to read and see and to understand. Also, we're translating the things that job is interested in when they might not be able to even deduce that from a CV, which isn't written that way. A CV is presented quite differently. So they used, of course, the buckets concept. And then what can you do to achieve the same? That's why we're here. The buckets, why are they so useful and important? They're easy for the human eye to catch. They're easily customizable for the applicant tracking system. And they help you to organize and present a complex and potentially disjointed story on just one or two pages. That's another big difference, right? A CV, the longer it is, sometimes the better. I once worked with a university president, and I think I mentioned this before. His CV was 37 pages. We brought it down to 27, but it was still, you know, something to be proud of. His cover letter was 2 pages, and it took us 16 hours to write, because that's where the story went. That was where the story needed to be. Okay, so this is where the job description analysis comes in, and I'm going to spend a fair bit of time on this because it's becoming central to my work life. In 2009, I got really frustrated with a client who kept sort of sending job descriptions to me and saying, hey, I think I want to apply for this job, but also I want to apply for that job. And I was like, wait, that is too much for me to sort of read your mind. I don't know sort of whether you have these skills or not. By the way, it's like 20 job descriptions, and I have to look through them and write a single document. So I created a matrix that you guys either have downloaded already or will, hopefully afterwards here. And I said, let's find a way to compare. Let's say you have a career path, and we're going to call that career path A that you're interested in. Find 3 to 5 job descriptions, and we're going to pull them apart. And we're going to say, okay, we're going to find all the like concepts, and then we're going to find things that are not alike. We're going to build around that Excel sheet, and I won't linger on it, because the directions are there, and it's much easier to understand if you've gone in and done it. I just realized there's no replacement for that, so understand that. But you're gonna start to see where, oh, there's repetitive information. That's what we're looking for. That repetitive information is basically sort of those buckets we're gonna build, the bones around which we're gonna tell the story. Yes?
For a lot of industries, especially I'm interested in journalism, for example. One of the first buckets that they hit is experience in journalism, and they tend to say, like, have you been working in this field in a professional capacity for 3 to 5 years or 5 to 10 years? And that seems like a big hurdle, especially when you've been in a PhD program. So I'm curious to know if that fits into this kind of a matrix, the just clear time element.
It fits into this matrix because it tells us something. It doesn't fit into the resume, and you can't claim to have something you don't. However, what I would do is I would say, collective experience in journalism, you know, I would say 2 years of or 3 years of experience collectively in journalism for, you know, with publications in X, Y, and Z, and I would make sure that that's front and center, because you can't claim that you have professional experience, but you can say, you know what I've been doing in this program is valuable. Whether you believe it or not, I'm going to tell you it is. And maybe they'll change their mind. That's how I would handle that. What I think is interesting about the job description analysis is it begins to say, okay, again, back to what we were sort of getting at, is it tells us how we're going to present the material. You'll also find that job descriptions are often written really hastily or by committee or any other thing, and you're going to be like, wow, that's the most that's a really badly written document. So, right, there's a lot of that, and unfortunately, you can sort of interpret. If someone is repeating that they need the same thing like 50 times in the same job description, you can assume that that skill set was not in the person who held the role before you. They're like, we really need someone who can do budgets, because that schlumpadinka before you didn't do budgets, and that's critical. Well, what that means, too, if it gives you a clue and says, okay, I'm going to sort of emphasize this, not only in the resume, but also in the interview. I am your solution when it comes to budgets, because I know that schlumpadinka before didn't have it. All right, so what we've done here is this job description analysis, we've sort of parsed it down into these categories, category findings, program development and management were previously separately, rather previously separate, but we've woven them together. Community partnerships was one of the pieces. There's community planning and partnerships, and we decided to sort of reduce it down to community partnerships and put planning in the narrative behind it. Facilities and operations, advocacy and communications. Again, what we're doing is looking for like ideas from everything that you've parsed and try to organize them in a nice way that's going to be thematic. Event planning and development. Again, this is available as that downloadable tool through UCHRI. What I find interesting is they usually don't come back this clean. They usually come back with like 30 rows full of like ideas, and it's really quite difficult. So you have to go through and make decisions about where that content is going to go. And this is not immediately obvious, and I'm sorry, but how do you sort of say, these are the categories, and then this is the content that goes into the categories? That's definitely a challenge, and it's just something you're going to have to wrestle with. All right. This is from one of your peers, and it was an email, so I'm sure that that person would like to have edited it had she known that it was going to be presented to you, but I'm going to read it anyway because it's super interesting. I did two things to figure out the buckets. One is painfully obvious in that I just looked at the duties and required skills section of the job calls. Job calls being synonymous with job descriptions, job ads as well. The other is a little less obvious, and this, I love it. She said, the other is a little less obvious in that I read the job ads in terms of my own strengths and thought about what kinds of skills I brought to the table that the jobs didn't explicitly ask for, but might implicitly be interested in. That I couldn't have said. I mean, it's incredible, and I think it shortcuts to that you need to sort of use your own reasoning to sort of this. It's not a hard and set way of doing things. It's just a tool. I really, really, really liked that. And so this is the person's dissertation. Let's not start that again. This is this person's CV. Let me get a drink of water. Instantly dry mouth. So this is their dissertation. Now, if we got that, we wouldn't necessarily know that they have program experience at all. Right? And so here is the role that's being sought. You can see at the very top, right? It says career target. That career target is awesome because you're able to actually put the name of the job title. Program and research manager. And then, again, we have, which of these is the, is that? No. I don't know where the laser pointer is, but you'll see that same table of competencies or core skills. Those are sort of important, but lesser than, because they're things that don't have big stories tied to them. They're just basically a bucket of keywords, which as you get more along in your career, you don't want to just put a bucket of keywords. However, we'll see that this person's job description analysis, here on the left, unfortunately it's too small to really see, so I'm just going to tell you, they decided to say, okay, humanities programming, publication preparation, research administration, and budget and expense management were the main things that they deduced out of that job description analysis. Notice, of course, that there is, do you have the experience? And is it something you plan on doing going forward? At this stage of the game, do you have the experience? One of the answers was no. Well, is it something you plan to do going forward? Maybe, right? Because you're selling something that you haven't necessarily done yet. So you need to be able to find a way to introduce that concept authentically so it's still a keyword. So you could say, you know, interested in, and put in the keywords, or exposure to some of those keywords. And then, by, for heaven's sakes, go read up on that topic, whatever it might be, so you know what the heck you're talking about, right? Exposure to means I Googled it and read a lot about it. I mean, so that's one example. Anatomy of a resume number two. One resume we know about scored 5 interviews and 4 job offers. And that was with one of the folks who I worked with one-on-one. The resume owner even had a full-time offer based on the resume alone. She declined it. She also didn't use buckets. So I was like, okay, Dana Linda, come on up. Give her a big hand. Thank you. I'm going to handle the clicker, so tell me if I need to advance, but I'll go ahead and turn the floor to Dana.
Okay, so thank you again, everyone, for being here today, and Jared just wanted me to kind of go through my process with translating the CV to a resume, and I initially met Jared at the Berkeley workshop, and sort of that, I was one of those skeptical grad students who was just like, who is this guy? Like, he doesn't even know what a dissertation is.
Yeah, I remember that moment.
And so I was defensive about, you know, the resume and what that meant for me and my work, because I just had my nose to the grind and I was really only thinking about academic jobs at that point in my own process. So I stepped back from that workshop. I took a look. I started studying Jared a lot, stalking him via the internet. And so what I did was, is I really, you know, started to think about, he has great templates, P.S., on his website.
Yeah, feel free to use them. Mm-hmm. Templates on the website, yeah.
And for me, I've always been a very much a visual learner. So in order for me to really absorb something and process it, I need to see it multiple times. It's the same with higher ed in many ways. So that process of taking, you know, this, which is my CV, and kind of cobbling it into multiple resumes for very different jobs. This is an example of, actually I use this for Humanist at Work. And a little bit about this resume, my partner at his company, they have to submit internal resumes. And so that's what this kind of model was built off of. This was not something that he would have submitted to, you know, a future employer. But at this point, you know, I was still sort of hesitant. So I think this resume actually models that I wasn't sure I was ready to like fully commit to the resume process. And then this is what we ended up with. So this was based on one of the more recent jobs that I applied to at the San Francisco Book Review, which for any of you that, you know, are tapped into the LA Book Review, similar organization. So a lot of the jobs I was applying to were copy editor positions, editorial work based on things I had done in my past. And part of the reason why I didn't use the buckets, because I didn't really understand them. And that goes back to me being a visual learner. So Jared would talk about them, you know, kind of narrate the process. And it wasn't clicking for me. I tend to think macro. I think that's part of the reason why I'm in comp lit. I think very broadly, broad-based. And so it was much easier for me to think on an institutional level. I also did a lot of programming residential education work at UCSC. So I was, you know, in the RA network. I worked on programs coordination. I really think sometimes looking back at my undergrad experience, I got my wires crossed a little bit, and I probably would have been just as happy in student affairs in many ways. So the reason why I did it this way was because I was able to sort of institutionally look at, and this doesn't even include all the things I've done for UC, but relative to editorial work, I was able to sort of remarket myself every time. So what we have on the right for this particular job, this is based on my JDA. We highlighted skills, kind of color-coded them. So these were based on the job call or the job search ad. I then, you know, highlighted the skills that they called for, and these are the ones that match up for me.
And this will be available, I believe, on online. Because what I thought was interesting is, okay, where did this content end up in a story that is it's authentic and it reads like a story, but it's obviously chock full of all of those keywords and phrases. So it's a really, I think, a super example. All right. So here's where it gets fun, and that means that I'm really, really a nerd about resumes. But we're going to talk about one of the exciting things, of course, working with Dana and some of the other folks in the room, has been that we now have examples. We've seen the full examples on their own, and now we're going to look at buckets, and we've organized them thematically. I don't want you to feel restricted. I want you to put your creative hats on, because your buckets may look very different, but these are what we have so far.
Oh. Buckets are a beautiful thing.
Yeah, who wrote that in an article? Someone wrote that in an article about their experience, and they wrote, one of their headers in the article was, buckets are a beautiful thing, and I could have just leapt out of my chair. I was like, yes, they are a beautiful thing. We're going to talk about sort of how to quantify information that isn't immediately quantifiable or doesn't seem quantifiable. And you'll want to quantify because that is all the rage in business, in the nonprofit world. You know, tell us how much you had your arms around. Tell us how much of an impact you had. The easiest and most sort of obvious is how much revenue did you bring in and how much cost savings. Well, probably none of that is going to resonate here. So, you know, sort of how many events did you put on over the course of what amount of time? You know, what were the event budgets? And maybe they were small event budgets, but you aggregate them and say, you know, total budgets of, and you give that total number. So that's sort of why we want to quantify. Here's another email that they probably would have rather have edited, but I'm not identifying who they are. So I'm just going to read it out loud since it's kind of small. This came to me over email. This person said, on another note, I wanted to mention that one of the most difficult aspects of creating this document, aside from establishing a chronology, which we're going to talk chronology in the breakout, was figuring out how to quantify entries. I understand why this is so important, but most of the work that a humanities graduate student performs isn't easily quantifiable, or, more correctly, isn't thought of as such. That being said, your example resume on the Humanists at Work website helped me think about how I might think more humanistic ways of quantifying, such as listing the different groups, departments, and publics that I work with. I don't know if other graduate students you have worked with have mentioned this, but one of the biggest takeaways from working with you was finding a humanistic way of quantifying my work. So, I mean, it's exciting to be able to say there are many things you can quantify and you can tell a realistic and real story.
So we're going to start with budgets and expense management because I think this is one of the more mystifying categories for a lot of people. And I don't think that's because we don't have experience doing this, but oftentimes, you know, you kind of have your hand, or not kind of, you do have your hand in a lot of different activities on campus and probably off campus as well. So sometimes it's hard to really take a step back and, you know, really be impressed by all the work that you've done. And so we're really interested also to hear from folks, you know, I'll generate an example of my own that might be helpful, but think about the kinds of experiences that you do have that resonate with budgets or expense or, you know, financial management of some sort. So for me, I had a hard time with this category because I don't consider myself, you know, I'm a humanities person. I don't work with numbers on an everyday basis. And it really took dialoguing with a friend in student affairs to make me realize, like, well, I do work with budgets. I was on the Humanities Council for quite a bit of time, and a part of our process was allocating funds to departments. And I didn't, you know, even think about the quantity of funds I was managing at that time, which was a lot. So that's just one example, but there's others, right? Does anybody want to shout them out if you've worked in conferences? Yeah? Anyone? Yeah? Louder? GSAs, yeah, definitely. So large budgets, right? Campus-wide, humanities division maybe longer, or sorry, wider than that. Yeah? Yeah, so right when you saw my and a few of the other example CVs, we actually didn't list the amount of funding we've acquired in terms of our grants. But if you ever think about those numbers, they're pretty significant. I'm sure for most of you, it's upwards, you know, to the $100,000 range of how much you've acquired over the years. So that's definitely a part of it, funding your own research. Yeah, Annie.
Why didn't you list the amount of money that you had earned?
I think it's just a stylistic preference. My advisor doesn't, you know, require that I do. I have in the past for other things, academic-related fellowships as well. Anyone else? Working groups? Does anyone sit on a board?
You can co-manage. You can have approval over budgets, right? Sat on a committee of, you know, the four-member executive committee and, you know, manage approvals over. You might not actually be managing it yourself, or you might say, you know, manage $10,000 segment of a $40,000 budget. Or you could even say in the executive summary, if you don't have a lot of budget management, put it in the executive summary, which we're not talking about today. We will at some point soon. Say budgets up to, and that up to is like, you know, up to 50% off. Oh my God, you go running down the to buy whatever you want to buy. This is up to, using that language to your benefit, because maybe you've managed a $12,000 budget. Well, you're probably not going to be given a $50 million budget right away, but the fact that you have managed a budget is important. And one other note to make as you go along and get increasing sort of levels of responsibility, you need to make sure and share P&L if you manage a P&L, a profit and loss budget, because if you manage a P&L, you're going to be much more eligible for a P&L, a profit and loss budget. That's the entire agency budget, whatever that might be. You're going to be more eligible for leadership roles. That's just a thing that people often don't know about ahead of time. So just make that mental note.
So I have a question about managing P&L budgets. What do you do when you've done it, but you did it because you worked at a nonprofit and basically the person who did it left, so they were like, now this is your job. And so like, what if you're not confident in your skills? So you've done it, but I'm not confident in it.
I would say assumed ownership of a $50,000 P&L in whatever date it was. And then I would probably go to, in San Francisco, we have something called Compass Point, or any of those sort of nonprofit leadership development organizations, and say, can you teach me what a P&L is? Because there's a lot to be learned, but it's really actually not rocket science. It's just, that's what I think you would do. Assumed ownership of, and then that's authentically stated and not overstated.
Okay, so program development management and or administration. So we worked with this category a little bit in the opening activity. And just something to note that I didn't point out on the last set of slides. So you'll notice, right, the buckets, the titles of each skill, right, is humanities programming, humanist at work, program development and management. So the language shifts depending on the call, right? So I wanna make those words stand out. So in terms of this, so just looking at the first example, delivered programmatic leadership and support across 3 statewide humanities projects and 20 fields of study, including 2 3-year grant-funded initiatives. So in terms of program development, again, what are some just, you know, word association things that come to mind, things that you've done, experiences that you've had? Programs. Did you organize a lecture for your department? Did you help a professor do that? A small reading group.
With a small budget.
With a small budget, great. Was it an ongoing reading group? Great, yeah, so that's a great example, right? Especially that you initiated it. Anybody else? Yeah.
I worked as a GSR at one of the resource centers on campus and created programs for graduate students.
What kinds of programs?
programs where they were building community with one another, potential skill sharing workshops and things like that.
Okay, so community and also professionalization.
And for quantifying, I hear how many students were impacted by those programs, how many programs altogether did you develop? Let's say there were five programs, including, and then you give the names of two that are the most resonant with the whoever the audience is going to be, you know, that reached a total of 300 students across two campuses. There's a way to quantify.
So I was the editor-in-chief of a journal.
Yes.
And also ran a conference.
Yeah, so, and that's great for publishing too, right? That you've actually edited a collection of a journal, maybe an ongoing activity. It's been, you know, archived.
And what's interesting to me about that is you probably have quite a lot of buckets you could translate that into. So whatever the job description analysis says, find what those connectors are and tell that story. Because it's the same story, you just have to frame it differently. There was one other, oh yeah.
I fell into working with another department, Classics, for my DE.
And for your, started, for your what?
Designated emphasis, sorry.
Designated.
I'm in English, but I work with Classics as a medievalist. And they were starting a program to try to get students to take a Classics course. And the program they implemented and that I've been helping with and has ended up being a GSR for me, we teach over 2,000 students a year. So that's been...
Which over 4 years would be 8,000 students. That's another thing, is to look at time and to sort of, you know, sort of multiply and figure out, all right, if you did this over 4 years or over 6 years, how many people did it impact over that period of time? That begins to amp up those numbers in a really exciting way. Another is, you know, that grew from 100 initial students to 2,000, or... sometimes you can present a range, like at a conference, you know, presenting to groups of five, which might be a board or a committee, to 800. And so that sort of says, yeah, I'm comfortable presenting and leading, facilitating.
Just a last comment, based on what Jared just said earlier. Well, your example was great with the journal. So, right, a lot of these categories do bleed into one another. And, you know, sometimes, you know, being in a PhD program, we get really narrowly focused on content and looking for jobs that fit our skills based on the content of the job. And that's important, right? But also an important part of this is the process. So being able to pivot and think about your role creatively and not just, you know, that I, you know, edited the Latin American journal on campus so I can only speak to.
Well, to that point, if I can go back to the program management piece, that is, you know, if you're looking at going into Google and you really want to manage the product, you're probably not going to do it right away, but you might get on a team. Program management is transferable because you're managing people, processes, timelines, release dates, right, deadlines. So those things are really transferable. And then if you take, again, that skill that you've identified and you drop it into LinkedIn, inside of quotes, or into Google, and see what other sorts of interesting roles does this pop out as. You might look up program management as one of your queries, program administration, and program, what was the other? Development. And see what they say discreetly, and if there's something that really sort of interests you, do a job description analysis on that type of job. So you're going to find, you know, 3 to 5 job descriptions that have that job title. And then you're going to break it down and find out, oh, I could actually do this. I just have to prove it on paper.
So this next one, for those of you that were able to go to the prior workshops, teaching was kind of a hot button issue. There was a lot of tension around these topics and how we can translate them, right? Especially outside, not just alongside, but mostly outside the academy. For most of us in the humanity, I would hope that we hold teaching very near and dear to our heart. So we put a lot of time and energy into our teaching. And this is a way to think about those roles dynamically, right? So instructor training taught 50 new students across 4 academic cycles with topics including curriculum scheduling, design, and techniques. Oh, sorry, instructors. So right, this is someone who's obviously working in a pedagogy training capacity.
Which, in a way, could be taught 50 new instructors, and that could be transferable to 50 new managers, because those instructors are then disseminating that information out. So there's one of the ways to be able to translate that.
Do you think that the instructional design and training could be transferable to something like program development, for instance? That could, just seems like such a broad category.
I remember at the Berkeley workshop, I was one of the people that was like, you probably watched the video, I'm like, teaching's a big deal. Like, it is project managed, like, nah. But, you know, I want to hear, yeah, what you think, honestly.
Right, okay. So, well, I'm never not honest.
Yeah.
I might, you know, soften things a little bit. Yeah. But teaching is not project management. It has a lot of the same elements. But one of the reasons it's not, and you just have to sort of know this, is that there is a certification called the PMP, Project Management Professional. And so it has almost in many ways become sort of codified as that. And so there's project management, and then there's project management light. And so that is one of those things people will raise their eyebrow and be like, what? But if you can talk about the cycle of managing those projects, right? Managed projects, and then just explain that project life cycle, that sort of helps you soften it and get around that noun or that sort of that thing that states it. The instructional design and training, however, is teaching just by another name. And it's what's being asked in that job ad. We're going to move on for the sake of time.
So research administration, this was interesting just to see how different folks on their resumes had had used descriptive, right, buckets. So we have research administration, archiving and releases, which stood out to me as the most sort of dynamic and differential, and then just research. So archiving and releases oversaw three member team recording, digitizing, and storing up to 5 terabytes of musical/digital content per week, included library management and borrowing permissions in collaboration with 18 partners, right? For example, vendors, peer departments.
That, by the way, all of the stuff in that middle one is big, because you're talking about how much happened per week, what size of the team it was. Small teams are fine, right? Large teams are great, doesn't matter. Borrowing permissions in collaboration with 18 partners. Collaboration is such a big word. Partnerships are such a big word. And those are, we've woven those into that story. And as it happened, this was an archiving and releases role because it was for a producer or something in LA. And but they were able to sort of use a lot of the important words that showed up elsewhere in the job description analysis, but within the context of the telling of the story rather than just branding the bullet point.
In the last question that came up about project management, you guys had presented a couple of different ways that you could kind of get around that, but then you kind of get into this gray area where you're potentially not satisfying the online tracking systems. So, like, how do you know? We're thinking about creatively reframing the kinds of skills we have developed in our PhD training. So when is it too creative and actually it's not going to get you what you need? Because that sounded like it was too creative.
Yeah. You should always be honest about, right, your, yeah.
By saying managing projects wouldn't necessarily get through the online. Yeah. You could. It depends on which of the applicant tracking systems there are, because there are 8, at last I knew, 8 different companies who are doing this. Actually, this brings up a really super good point, because I hate applicant tracking systems a lot. And the people who use them, who I write for, hate them. They hate them as users. I hate them. So in other words, bypass it. Do a networking, say 10% of the work I do is going to go into posted ads. The rest of the 90% are going to say, okay, some person somewhere put this out. Let me find out who that person is and send it to them directly. Or who do I know that, and start networking and saying, you know what? I'm sort of at this point in my life or my career and blah, 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 where the best opportunities come from networking and from your network, whether that is a network you already have or that you build. And boy, that's a whole topic unto itself. But yeah, I'm glad you brought it up, because I would spend 10% in the black hole that is job ads. We're just using it. For me, the job description is just as research, but I would look at that as a lottery. It's just like playing the lottery and is about as helpful.
Oh, grant writing. And hopefully most of us feel comfortable, right, with this category. So in terms of funding, and this can go back to what we were talking about earlier with budgets, grant writing and development, one, $350K and team and individual national, international, and institutional grants across humanities and social sciences, see addendum.
By the way, that team piece, if you notice, that number is, you know, 350,000. They're not claiming that it's just themselves who won it. It's one, 350K in team and individual. So that's an aggregate number that is being told authentically, and it's important because you had visibility into it in some way, whether you did it yourself or it was as part of a team.
And I think that's more transferable for humanistic social sciences, right, than for a lot of us who are in maybe individual track literature departments, for example, right? A lot of the research, even with that category, was couched in team-oriented language, when in the reality, for most of us, we're doing our research independently. Funding management revised 15 existing calls for funding and wrote new graduate student support grant for 11 UC campuses, totaling.
Yeah, and funding management or fund management is something that is transferable across a lot of industries, all the way from sort of managing investment portfolios to working at a foundation as a program officer or at that point probably a program associate. So fund management or funding management is a great one to talk about. That's a euphemism for you for grant writing and grant development and getting those grants. And by the way, if you have a high number of grants that you've received versus the, not RFPs, but the proposals, what are they called? The grants that you've written and sent out, how much has been awarded? If that's a pretty high number, put the percentage. You know, wrote X number of grants and won, you know, won 75% of grants that ever went out, totaling this much money. That's awesome.
Publications and editorial. So we had a few different examples of how individual participants, you know, worded this. So communication design, publication preparation, and research and publishing. So here's an example with dissertation-oriented work. Produced 250-page manuscript on Victorian and modernist poetry, as well as two academic articles, included week-long research at Dublin, Ireland National Library using archival sources related to Irish prosody and the 1916 Easter Rising. So
what's interesting to me, if I can, is that communication design on the top. This is all about public publishing, right? And I think, is it about the dissertation?
That one's not.
Okay. Yeah. But communication design, I think that's one of the great euphemisms that we have in this whole presentation. And so look that up and see, okay, is communication design something that's being asked for and what kinds of jobs does that look like? Okay, I can tell my story under that bucket.
Okay, community and volunteering. So this could be work that you're doing alongside the degree or, you know, with any of these categories, you're perfectly and able to think back of other experiences and feel empowered by the work you've done prior to your PhD. So we have community outreach and partnerships. Example, key contributor to expanding the in-jail writing workshops from 2 to 7 Santa Cruz County facilities. That was me, just throwing it out there. I forgot as I was reading it that it was me. Partnership management, constituent relations, community partnerships. And you'll see again, classroom instruction and administration is bracketed under this category. So again, these are mobile, right?
One of the most interesting things to me is that second bullet, which says partnership management, constituent relations, that could very easily have been community involvement or community relationships, that sort of thing. But in this instance, it's one of those, like, just flip the, change the branding of the bullet and you meet the applicant tracking system plus that human reader's needs.
So when Jared and I were going through the bucket organizational schema, the one thing I kept thinking about was, you know, how to not only translate the CV to a resume, but translate the resume back to a CV in order to talk about it today. So really thinking about your service work, right? All those things that you do that are at the bottom of your CV that aren't emphasized, and blowing them out. So here we have service buckets that are related to event programming, event development logistics, event development management. And these are huge, right? And this goes back to conferences that you've been a part of planning, working groups, any departmental, institutional, campus, UC-wide events that you're a part of. I mean, really, being a part of the UC, we, you know, that in itself is a really important brand. And it's important to capture that in your resume.
The fourth one, event development and management. So this has a lot of quantification, and I had to redact the names of the institutions, but I'm going to read it real quickly. Produced 7 to 12 events annually, and then the kinds, performances and exhibitions, for audiences of 100 to 3,000. Represented, and then the organization name. So they were a representative of the organization at, and then they listed some of the other institutions. Now, it wasn't all of them, but it was the ones that were going to make the biggest impact. You know, at the Ford Foundation and the Gates Foundation, and those things that are going to catch the eye and be really, really interesting. You have to sort of do some guessing and sleuthing about what the audience might, or what the recipient might appreciate. But yeah, that's a gold, you have a gold mine of this sort of stuff. Just pull out the ones that are going to resonate most. If you wanted to move into tech, you know, represented the UCHRI at the Dreamforce convention in 2014, Dreamforce being Salesforce, for instance. Okay. This is a checklist that we don't have time for, but I'm going to show it to you, and these slides are going to be on the website available later. I just have to redact a few things. But actually, I'll let Dana handle the first chunk.
Okay. So, things you did before UC. So think about community involvement. What kinds of volunteerships, internships did you participate in? Nonprofit, NGO work, volunteering again. Education abroad. Did you go abroad in your, you know, undergraduate? Or even as a, this can also be within the UC, a lot of folks who work in the languages, language departments, right? So were you part of that, you know, UC Paris program, or, you know, taking students to Granada and cultural immersion, right? Not just the linguistic aspect, but thinking about it more broadly in what you did. Peace Corps. And these are just things I kind of came up with on the fly. Are there anything else that is missing here? Things that you did before UC? Yeah. Yeah, I mean, some of these could be, too, right? Like, and so can you give me an example? Yeah, so working in a hospital.
Yeah, in fact, what we're going to be doing in the breakout is figuring out what to do with that. Sort of, there are things you're doing along in your sort of academic experience, but what do you do with the other, whether they came before or they're happening on the side?
One thing I worry about the work that we've done before tends to be like 5, maybe 10 years before, because we've been doing nothing else but dissertating. Does that look bad that it's that long ago that there might be some before?
I hope you all heard that, but no, it doesn't look bad, because what you can then do is open up your executive summary and say 10 years of professional and academic experience, including 3 years in something, what you did earlier, and the balance in something. So it shows that you're not, if you just say, you know, 2 years experience, it's not acknowledging the whole breadth that you bring to the world. So yeah, I would totally bring that experience in. As time goes by and you have 25, 35 years experience, then we start dropping stuff, but not now. Yeah. I want to jump real quickly, because of time, to quantifying the work. And I've just made a list. This is by no means exhaustive. This is Dana and I were sitting there like trying to fit all this stuff onto one slide very, very quickly. But so quantifying your work could involve the annual budget or of the organization with which you worked. If you work at Apple, that's a $187 billion company. So that shows a framework of the kind of culture you're familiar with. You could you know, you could talk about the size of the department, but what if you talked about the size of UC as a whole, right? That's one way to sort of show scope and quantifying. I will leave you to answer the, or to look at the rest later in the quiet. And I think that's an important way to maybe end this. And unfortunately, it seems like we don't have time for Q&A, but I'll be eating lunch. If you want to ask me some cues, that's fine. But I think a great way to end it is this is going to happen. The most interesting things are going to happen when you are sitting there at your computer on your own, quietly wrestling with this work. Okay, so thank you very much to Dana for joining us.
No problem.
Oh, okay. Thank you to everyone for participating, and let's hold.